My name's Kurt Krieger. I'm with the law firm of Steptoe & Johnson, and it truly is my pleasure to be up here with a distinguished group of panelists. Let me take a moment and introduce everybody up here. Commissioner Tony Clark is a commissioner on the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, appointed in June of 2012. Prior to his appointment, he served 12 years on the North Dakota Public Service Commission, most recently as chairman of that commission. He's also served in the cabinet of North Dakota governor and is a former North Dakota legislator. While at the North Dakota Commission, he oversaw regulatory proceedings that permitted more than $5.5 billion in new energy infrastructure investments. To his left is Greg Ebel, who's the chairman, president, and CEO of Spectra Energy and Spectra Energy Partners, and is on the board of DCP Midstream, which is jointly owned by Spectra. Spectra owns natural gas liquids, and crude oil pipelines, and related storage facilities throughout North America. Greg has served in senior executive roles with other gas and electric companies and was chief of staff to Canada's Minister of Finance and Deputy Prime Minister. He is a current member of the National Petroleum Council and is a former chair of INGA, or the Interstate Natural Gas Association of America. Next, we have David Foley, who's the CEO of Blackstone Energy Partners, which invests broadly in the energy value chain. He is responsible for overseeing Blackstone's private equity investment activities in the energy and natural resource sector on a global basis, has been responsible for building that practice, and played an integral role in every private equity energy deal in which Blackstone has invested. David serves on the boards of multiple global energy companies. We also have with us William, or Will Brilliant, who's a principal of Global Infrastructure Partners, which is focused on the natural resources sector. In his 16-year career, he has been involved in energy transactions worth over $30 billion in value, including Global Infrastructure Partners' most recent investments in Access Midstream Partners and the Ruby Pipeline. So to kick things off, and as we've recognized from this morning discussion, the environment has certainly changed quite a bit, but I'd like to ask each one of you to share with us your views and thoughts on just how big the need is for energy infrastructure in the U.S., everything from power generation to gas, liquid, oil pipelines, LNG facilities, other export facilities, whatever. Starting with you, Commissioner.
Sure, Kurt, thanks. And thanks for the invitation to be with you here. I think what we're learning is that our infrastructure needs are huge across the country, and it crosses many industry sectors, from gathering, from midstream pipeline companies, from electric generation, from wires companies, traditional pipeline companies. It's really soup to nuts, a huge issue that the country is having to come to terms with, because what we're finding is, this has been reconfirmed many times over, as we've known in the past, we don't have a supply problem in this country when it comes to energy. Folks have been predicting the end of gas, the end of oil, the end of coal, the end of this, the end of that for decades, and it's never turned out. There's always technological revolutions which provide us with the ability to supply our own energy resources. The latest one that has fallen into our laps, as everyone knows, is the shale revolution that has happened across the wide swaths of the country and fell into our laps at precisely the time when we needed it the most. I would hate to think what electricity prices, for example, would be like right now today if we hadn't had this shale revolution that happened. All of those applications, the voluminous applications that reside at FERC that used to say LNG import terminals, or it says import, it's now been scratched out and they all say LNG export terminals. But what we are finding is, and it's driven home by the prices we're seeing in specific markets, both on the gas side and on the electric side, is we do have a major infrastructure problem. And we have a major infrastructure problem in very specific parts of the country and for very different reasons. And we're now seeing what the price of that infrastructure challenge that we have in parts of the country is. FERC staff recently gave us their winter assessment at a recent commission meeting where they look out and project for the commission for price and reliability purposes what we look like we're seeing across the different markets that FERC oversees, most especially gas and electricity. the area of the country, which is, I guess, the point of the spear on this, and many folks have acknowledged it, is the Northeast, specifically as you get towards New England. If you want to look at the price of a lack of infrastructure and what it means to consumers, consider a couple of facts. If you look at the Dominion South region pricing point, which is basically a proxy for the Marcellus region of the country for natural gas, FERC staff looked at January and February winter contracts. Those contracts were selling for about $2.85. Now, as you all know, that's cheap gas. That's dirt cheap gas. And in some ways, it might be too cheap because it may not be supportive of the infrastructure that continues to develop the product. If you look a little bit further up the pipeline constraints, you go to Transco Zone 6, which is basically a proxy for the heart of the mid-Atlantic, Philadelphia, South Jersey, that area. Those forward contracts were a little over $9, $9.09. That's expensive gas. It's not unheard of to have winter gas prices in that range. It's sort of what you might expect for some winter-type forward contracts if you're looking at a colder-than-average winter. Now go just a little bit further up geographically. Now, I realize as a North Dakotan, I have probably a skewed vision of what's a small geographic area and what's a large geographic area, but it's not that far from Pennsylvania into New England and near the Boston city gates. Algonquin City Gates, Boston pricing, New England pricing, those forward contracts, $21.45. That's sky-high gas in a country that has a glut of natural gas. That's the price of not having adequate infrastructure. If you look at some of the New England electric utilities, New England, very gas-dependent region of the country for its electricity generation, they're reporting to their state regulators retail rates that could be around and above about 25 cents a kilowatt hour. That's extraordinarily expensive electricity. It's the kind of electricity prices that up to this point you really only see in very constrained areas like island economies, maybe Hawaii or Puerto Rico or somewhere like that. But in essence, New England is becoming a bit of an infrastructure island. And that's the price that is paid by consumers when you don't have that adequate infrastructure. So from my perspective, sitting in the FERC, one of the things that I think we need to focus in on is find those ways from a financing standpoint, from a market structure standpoint, to encourage the infrastructure that needs to be developed so that consumers across the country can see the benefits of this enormous energy resources that we have.
Thank you, Tony. Greg?
Well, first of all, it was great to hear what the commissioner had to say, because as one of those expanding the Algonquin pipeline system, which we own, I think he said our FERC certificate's going to be fast line through so we can get it approved. So that's
close,
what I heard.
Anyway. Close my ears.
Look, the challenge is huge, but the opportunity is huge as well. The Interstate Natural Gas Association did a study a year ago working with ICF. And to put some context around the type of capital numbers we're talking, that Tony's talking about, the needs required. If you took North America through 2030, the number for natural gas pipelines, oil pipelines, gathering and processing, and related infrastructure is about $600 billion. So call it in the terms of, you know, somewhere between $45 and $60 billion a year of new natural gas infrastructure. If you threw in the refining capacity associated with that and the rest of the infrastructure that would be needed for that part of the business, it's probably about $800 billion a year. Over a 15-year time frame, that is not an unimpressive number. It's all got to get financed. Much of it's got to get through, if it doesn't have to get through FERC, it's got to get through state entities. Put it in context, what the average dome stadium runs, probably $800 million. So, you're basically building 1,000 dome stadiums between now and 2030. That is stunning to think that will happen. But it is critical from a price perspective. It's very expensive. Not a lot of this infrastructure is huge. We just built Spectra Energy in November 2013, after getting our FERC certificate, built a pipeline into Manhattan, the first pipeline into Manhattan in 40 years, which is not only a national security issue, but obviously critical from an economic perspective. Went through New Jersey, went into Manhattan, basically Midtown, which isn't easy, as you know, to build anything there. 20 miles of pipe, but $1.2 billion, and it took 4 years to get it approved. So what's the economic payback of that? The economic payback is colossal, because it's approximately $700 million a year for both New Jersey and New York City residents. And prior to that pipeline being built, Tony talked about some of the prices you're seeing in New England. The same thing was happening in New York. So the winter before, and if you basically levelize for weather, the winter before, New York citizens were basically paying a 65 or 70% premium for that gas. Virtually the day after that pipeline went into service, the premiums last year averaged about 13%. So that's the kind of dramatic impact you can have. Not only help citizens from a cost perspective, industry, it's also equivalent to taking about 250,000 cars off the road. Could not have been done without the support of Mayor Bloomberg, Governor Cuomo, the federal government, and Governor Christie. That's not four groups of folks that tend to get on the same page in a real hurry, but obviously that just underlines the challenge that we have in part of the size.
Very good. David?
So I guess, as Greg mentioned, the midstream part of the spending has been running in recent years at close to $50 billion a year within the U.S. Downstream and refining is about half that, and they're both kind of dwarfed by the upstream spending, which has been close to $350 billion a year in the U.S. So that, you know, you add it all up, around $425 billion in the hydrocarbon chain, you know, oil and gas. And then with electricity, it's been a bit lower, but in all of these cases, I think, and I know you're going to talk a little bit more about how regulation can both help and perhaps impede some of these projects, it's the investments driven firstly by economic opportunities, so fundamental economics. People talk about the basis differentials in natural gas. Forget about the difference between, you know, Henry Hub in Japan, you know, just the difference between one side of New York and the other side. So if you have that economic opportunity in a country that has a tremendous number of entrepreneurs and folks will go out and try to marry that supply with demand and take advantage of that opportunity, marry that up with capital providers, and I think you've seen a tremendous amount of investment in the U.S. that has really accrued to the benefit of citizens in the country. We've got lower energy prices here. The energy industry provides a lot of taxes to the U.S. economy. So I think it's a great place to be an investor.
Great. Will?
Yeah, well, I would echo some of the comments that Greg and David just made. I think we see the same numbers in terms of opportunity. We don't play in the E&P part of the value chain, so we're really just an infrastructure investor. And really, this is probably our number one sector as we look around the world in terms of investment opportunity. And I think it all starts with the supply success that David talked about in terms of what E&P companies have done here. We, up until recently, you know, were an owner of Access Midstream, which is a gathering and processing MLP. And in that entity, we were very close to the supply side of the equation and investing $1 billion to $1.5 billion of capital every year out of that entity to just connect wells. And the success, I think, that the production side has had really sets up the infrastructure opportunity that we see that ultimately plays out in a demand response that you're starting to see from manufacturing returning to the U.S. Talked about the benefits to the consumer of lower energy prices, et cetera. So we think we're in the early innings of this, you know, decades-long, hundreds of billions of dollars of infrastructure that needs to be spent. And really, it's just the fundamental success of the supply that sets up, you know, the opportunity that we see.
Will, maybe staying with you, what are the good investments when you're kind of prioritizing capital dollars? And if you can add into that just kind of some of the things we've talked about, there's been a lot of discussion about collapse in the price of a barrel of oil, but translating that over to the gas side, we represent a lot of producers in the shale plays. Years ago, we saw them all move their rigs to the rich gas plays. Do you have a concern to the extent the price of NGLs is based off the price of a barrel of oil, not of gas? How's that affecting your kind of outlook on where to put your dollars?
Sure. Well, I think a couple things about where we operate that may be different. You know, we're a private equity fund, effectively a long-term investor that doesn't really play for the short term. And I mentioned we don't play on the E&P side. So we don't make decisions based on the short-term commodity outlook. What I think we see generally in terms of the supply success I talked about is that supply is a bit ahead of demand at the moment, probably across all the commodities. And you're starting to see the demand response. On the gas side, it's LNG exports, it's petchem manufacturing coming. We're an investor in Freeport LNG, as an example. So we see really a strong platform across all of the commodities as we look out over the next 4 or 5 years and a decade. So there will be some price dislocation, and the commodity markets are obviously experiencing it right now. But I think that's just a stimulus for demand, both on gas, NGL, and then I think, you know, crude oil. We've had a lot of talk about crude oil, you know, here today, and I think we're not in the business of making the crude oil price. But I would tend to agree with some of the comments about when you look at the longer term supply demand fundamentals, and you get, you know, a steady progression of demand over the next few years. I think you've got to think about where's the marginal cost of supplying that demand over time. And so we think the U.S. Value chain across the commodity stack is looking attractive for investments in infrastructure. So that's, I guess the short answer is, whether it's oil, gas, or liquids, we think the infrastructure needs to come, and we think the supply is going to continue to need to find a home.
Okay. David, thoughts?
Yeah, I think as a private equity provider and not infrastructure fund, which may be focused on a bit lower risk and willing to accept a more moderate return, and also not a large MLP corporate, we need to seek out really opportunities where we can earn reasonably high rates of return. So we're handicapped a bit by having a higher equity cost of capital, but then again, we'll take educated risk. So we view ourselves as risk and growth capital. And within the energy sector, because of the commodity price cycles, which we're all experiencing right now with crude oil, because of the regulatory changes and growth, it's really a great place to have that kind of pool of capital to invest. Also, not being kind of all in all the time, but having dry powder on the sidelines to go and invest through a transformative period, and then monetize or hand that asset off after we've incubated it and built it to a larger MLP or to an infrastructure fund or a regulated utility. So that's where we've chosen over the years to spend our time and invest. And it's, in a way, first thing I had to learn going from before I started focusing on energy, I've been at Blackstone almost 20 years, and the first years was just doing regular buyouts. And the first thing I had to learn was a lot more patience, because building things takes a lot more time than just buying them. And 75% of the capital we've deployed within energy at Blackstone has been involved in building and growing things. And the permitting process takes quite a long time. That's can be frustrating, but the good news is that if you get through that process and you do it the right way, you've really got something of value. And so we look to, it's kind of like a venture infrastructure thing. We see inefficiencies in the market going from entrepreneurs who bootstrapped through the first few years and maybe trying to get a permit, and they can do that for a few million dollars, and then all of a sudden they need hundreds of millions or billions, and they can get caught in the middle, especially when the time frame to build these assets is multi-year periods. So we can actually bridge that, and we can help the entrepreneur secure the permit, secure financing, and think through the strategy. And I think examples of that would be, when we invested in Cheniere a few years ago, the company had a relatively small market cap then, needed $12 billion to get Sabine Pass facility rolling. We committed initially $2 billion equity amount to get that rolling before it had all of its offtake agreements, before it had its final permits, before it had a final construction agreement with Bechtel. That's the kind of thing we love doing. We see opportunities now, not just in the oil and gas side, but also in power transmission. That's a whole other set of infrastructure that is being driven by primarily regulatory changes, because U.S. power demand isn't really growing gangbusters, and it's hard to export electricity. But within the U.S., the way the grid was set up was really set up within each state to kind of distribute power from each state's generating utilities, and we've had tremendous shifts in the nature of power generation driven by policies that encourage renewable power generation to be added to the grid, which is great in that it doesn't generate CO2, but it's not kind of on-off switch. It's a bit more variable in nature, and that creates problems. Coal assets getting retired, a lot of baseload assets like nuclear being retired, and that creates all kinds of problems for the grid. So one of the investments that we've been nursing along over the last few years has been in a project called the Champlain-Hudson Express, which would bring 1,000 megawatts of power down from Quebec, from renewable sources, into New York City. It's similar, I guess, on the electricity side to what you're doing with hydrocarbons, Greg. And there's a process, Article 7, New York State. It takes a long time, but at least it's coordinated. They coordinate all the various permits you need into that one. And we filed for that back in March of 2010. We finally got that. We also got a presidential permit, which we were thrilled about. Obviously, some other projects like Keystone taken a bit longer for that. I think it helped that this project was renewable power. It was delivering it from one of the lowest cost sources of power on the continent to one of the highest priced power markets. Didn't require any federal or state subsidies, and it'll reduce the cost of power in New York City by $650 million. So those types of things are what we're looking at, really transformative events, things that aren't easy for the capital markets, which tend to have a one quarter or one year ahead focus on to do. And what we're going to see now in the oil side of the business is projects that can be perfectly good projects, but they're not online yet. They have a heavy CapEx spend over the next year or two. Very difficult for even the larger companies to continue to fund their dividend, have a 40% collapse in their top line. They're going to have to consolidate and reshuffle their portfolios, and having billions of capital on the sideline, just looking for opportunities, it's now a great place to be. We've been selling our oily assets over the last 18 months. We exited GeoSouthern to Devon in February for $6 billion. We got out of a company up in the Duvernay Shale to Chevron late last year. So we haven't been buying any oil for the last 18 months. We've been buying gas. And now maybe it'll shift back around.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. A bit of a disadvantage. You don't have production people up here, E&P. So, look at Spectra from a gas perspective. We move 12, 15% of the gas that moves in North America every day and process the largest processor of natural gas. But if I look at Spectra Energy Partners, which is our $20 billion MLP, despite the collapse in commodity prices on the oil side, gas is held in there, there's not one iota difference of the amount of cash we'll make this year or next year or the year after, or the year after that, frankly. Because our projects that we build take anywhere from 18 to 24, 36 months to get approved. Before we put any steel in the ground, they have long-term contracts. So it's kind of like building a hotel, selling all the rooms out for 10, 15, or 20 years in advance with our customers either being utilities or producers of natural gas. And so you're not exposed to the commodity piece of things. And I think that goes back to the longer term view of where do you think NGLs, natural gas, and our oil are going to be for the next 10 or 15 years? Because that's, this business is basically a 10% business. You don't get your return on or of capital kind of year 8 to 10. And they stay in service for, 50 to sometimes 100 years, these pipes, right? They get reworked and all that kind of thing. So the short term commodity prices, despite what the stock market does for all the stocks in the energy sector, is really not affecting the infrastructure business. Now, if commodity prices stayed where they were for a very, call it a 24-month period, which would be pretty incredible. So remember 2009, September of 2008, we kind of saw oil prices go from whatever they were, $100 plus, to, $40, $50. NGLs went from $1.20 a gallon to 50 cents. It was colossal, the world was ending, it's a whole variety of other things. By the start of 2010, NGLs were back up to $1.10. So I'm not predicting that today, but it would take a sustained period of low prices for projects that are really designed to serve people for 10, 15, or 20 years to not go forward. So really, the impact on the infrastructure side, you're going to stay busy for a few years, Tony, probably wouldn't occur until kind of that 17, 18, 19 time frame.
Tony?
Well, from a FERC perspective, of course, the commodity prices are what they are, and investors will make their decisions on where they wish to invest. But from what FERC's role in it is slightly different depending on what type of pipeline you're talking about. If you're talking about a liquids pipeline, FERC has rather limited jurisdiction over those. They're regulated under the Interstate Commerce Act. But FERC does have an important role on the financing side, which is, although we don't do the environmental permitting, the sort of pipes in the ground permitting that's done at the state level, What we do is we issue, oftentimes what are called petitions for declaratory order, and those are really the things to watch as you look at pipelines that are being developed. They're essentially advanced rate-making principles that we will give investors and companies so they have a sense for how, and shippers that may wish to contract, so they have a sense for how the pipeline will be financed and the rates will be charged. And we've been busy on that front. We've had, I think, just in the last few years, over 30 of those PDOs, petitions for declaratory order, on the liquid side. Natural gas, of course, is much more comprehensively regulated at the federal level, and it is exclusively at the federal level if you're talking about any sort of interstate pipeline, both the economics of it, the rate setting of it, and the actual physical environmental siting of the natural gas line itself. In terms of hurdles to that sort of development that we've seen, I'm sure investors, when it comes to things like ROE, they'd always prefer more to less and sooner rather than later, but I haven't heard a lot of concern about the lack of credit supportive ROEs at the FERC level. I think it's generally regarded as a fairly stable and predictable regulator. But where we have seen a challenge, especially on the natural gas side, in these parts of the country that I talked about where there are new natural gas pipelines that are needed, is really a breakdown, not so much in the natural gas market, it's in the regulatory construct on the electric market that needs to finance the lines to bring the pipelines to bring the gas in. And that's a very fundamental challenge in certain parts of the country, not so much in others, but it tends to be in parts of the country where states have, on their own, have restructured the electric industry, have created a merchant fleet of generators, electric generators, operating within a wholesale market. And the mismatch between how the electric market runs and how pipelines have traditionally been financed and constructed is a hurdle. It's one that FERC has been doing an intellectual deep dive on, and will probably result in, has been encouraging changes in the different electric markets, ISO New England, PJM, and the like.
Yeah, I think just adding on that, the point that this brings together as well, you sort of got more of the production side of things when you talk about commodities here. As Tony talks about, there's two ends of the pipe, right? There's the supply side and there's the demand side. So low prices don't make our, call it a third of our customers, our production side, but two-thirds of our customers are on the demand side. So, you know, $3.50, $4 gas is wonderful electric prices if you can get it there. And, you know, lower oil prices, while I don't think a sustained low oil price is great for the whole economy, you see it in the press every day and everybody got a tax cut or our gas is cheaper. Now, the fact that energy provides so much of the economy, your gas might be cheaper, but if there are no jobs from the energy sector, may not be cars needed to be bought. But, you know, the demand side is a really critical component here. So we kind of, on the infrastructure side, we like the prices to be just enough to produce it and just enough to want to keep consuming it, right? So that $3 to $5 price range for gas is a real sweet spot. Oil, we'll see as it plays out on the shale side and the cost of producing shale oil comes down, just like gas did. You may find that, you know, $60, $70, maybe $80 oil is quite economic for both the producer as well as the user.
Commissioner, let the record reflect that you brought up the rate of return issue. So, so I'd like to play into that a little bit more. How does the panel feel about regulated rates of return? Good, bad? Now's your chance, Greg.
Well, you know, look, I think that at the returns in the pipeline, I'm always of the view, look, this is a 10% business. And you know, sometimes we can make 13 or 14%. Sometimes early projects you might make, you know, 7 or 8% just covering your cost of capital. For the pipeline business, it's less an issue than it is for the electric business and the utilities per se, because we generally have long-term negotiated contracts. We don't do anywhere near the amount of rate cases that they used to do at FERC. You know, most of the projects we build, whether it's in New England, you know, our big project here into Manhattan or Florida, they're negotiated rates, which you guys look, and if they're fair and in the public interest, move forward. So I think it's fine, and obviously MLP structures allow us to really appropriately, Commissioner, improve our returns through some tax structuring. So I think that's and that's been litigated at the FERC level too, and been very supportive. So I don't have a problem with the rates of return from a long-term perspective in that business.
David and Will, I'd like to hear you talk on that, and then if I can add on to it from your perspectives, where is all the money coming from, and what are the preferred investment vehicles, you know, the MLPs and so forth?
Sure. I'd echo what Greg said. I think that your regulated rates of return are fine for certain kinds of asset classes. It can make sense when there's, you know, natural monopolies, and also when it's something that is pretty mature and people understand, you know, here's how to build a pipe, this is a basic power grid, pretty straightforward, now it's not always most efficient in that, you know, it tends to be what's your rate base and cost plus, so it may not be quite as disciplined on the providers to get their, like on the oil and gas side where it's the opposite of regulated, you know, it, right. It's a bit of the Wild West. And look at the productivity improvements those guys have achieved. Would they have done the same if that was a highly regulated and a rate of return type of industry? Probably not, because of the rate of innovation. But I think it's a perfectly appropriate financing model for you know, like the local monopoly types of businesses, for relatively mature asset classes. I think it does just fine in some of the environments that we're in now, where there's a need for a more rapid deployment of construction, building assets, building things that didn't exist before, like, you know, LNG export facilities. That I think draws a bit more on the capital markets, unregulated. So folks like Greg at Spectra, private providers like Global Infrastructure Partners, Blackstone can move, you know, a little more quickly. And sometimes, you know, people can lose money doing that. But the good news is that if you pick your management teams, your partners well, and you back well-structured projects, you can make better than a regulated rate of return. So I think both there's room in the energy market in the U.S. for that whole spectrum, and I think you've got it on the stage here, the whole spectrum of capital providers. I guess in terms of your related question, where it comes from, in the upstream, most of it comes from upstream companies, from integrated oil companies. A very large part, I guess around $50 billion a year or so, comes from the MLP market, which I think is a great example of, you know, American, you know, entrepreneurs meeting with an efficient kind of capital market setup for investors and retail investors to invest in a tax-efficient manner in infrastructure growth. So that's been a huge success for the United States that I haven't seen replicated in many other markets around the world. So I think if you've got those types of infrastructure projects, pipe, storage, et cetera, the MLPs are really a very good way to finance that. Where we play as private equity does tend to be a little more on the riskier side of it, right? So a bit more where there's commodity exposure, either directly in the upstream, or, you know, petroleum refining is probably the opposite of what you'd want to have in a, at least the whole refiner anyway, in an MLP, although certain pieces of it are, you know, the storage and pipelines make sense. But we've been successful investors in refining. Merchant power is kind of outside of the regulated base. So we tend to invest in things that do have some of a risk element to it. They have a growth element to it. And we can earn a bit better rates of return for taking that risk.
Okay. Well,
yeah, I think I largely agree with those comments. I think, for the more mature asset classes, I think, regulated model, particularly when you've got monopoly type dynamics, certainly makes sense. And I think you can see in the capital markets today, I mean, there's no shortage of capital to fund the infrastructure development that's going on right now. I think if you look at the top five or six midstream companies, they're doing, $5 billion of growth capital a year on average. You pretty quickly get up to the needs in terms of funding the development. So I think the market is working. I think we should keep in mind that some of that is a function of the rate environment we're in. And so, MLPs have been extremely successful. They deliver a yield. They're also part of a growing sector. So you've got sort of, two parts of your return there. You're seeing that model, move into yield cos on the generation side. There's even talk of sort of transmission REITs being the next leg of that growth. So I think this notion of, funding assets that can generate a stable yield of cash flow in vehicles like that has got a ways to run. And I think particularly for those that have a good fundamental growth story, I think while rates will pressure over time, some of the attractiveness of that market, I think the underlying growth in a lot of those asset classes is probably going to overwhelm, and so that'll be positive. So I think, you know, not unlike what David said, I think where private capital like ours can play is, you know, we don't play in the commodity side, but you know, we've got a big operational team, and that's where we've invested our resources to try to generate the incremental return and invest in projects that may not be ready for the more mature cash-flowing stages of development and financing. And so I think it certainly is, there's an abundance of capital in the market today, and I think the challenge on all of us capital providers, operators, is finding those edges, whether you're an operator and you're taking an existing asset and, you know, doing a brownfield project as part of this infrastructure solution, or whether you're a private capital provider like us and figuring out, you know, what's our advantage, what can we do to operate these assets a little bit differently or help grow the business in a way that, you know, it couldn't otherwise be grown.
I'd like to talk a little bit about demand side and exporting. This morning I heard again someone say that probably the most that the U.S. can hope for in exporting natural gas is about 10 BCF. I heard it last week at another conference, and yet we know there's probably 30 to 35 BCF of proposed export projects, I think, if I've got my numbers right. The ones that have been approved, I believe, if you add up the numbers, would maybe cover the 10 BCF, recognizing that they've got to get financed and built, and they're years out. Do you have a bias about that, an opinion? And Commissioner, are you concerned about continuing to certificate things if you're worried that there is not an export market for gas?
Well, from a FERC perspective, we let the market decide those types of issues about what's going to get ultimately built, if they can get the financing, and if they can get their customers lined up, then that happens outside of the FERC process. From a FERC standpoint, what we're really focused in on is the environmental siting, the construction of those facilities, and ensuring that we have a process that adequately handles the significant workload that we've got right now. FERC, I think, has a fairly good process for how we handle applications that come in the door. In my opinion, I think DOE has updated and reformed theirs in a way that's positive, that coordinates a little better with the FERC process. The challenge that had happened for developers for so many years was when an application from an environmental siting standpoint walks in the door at FERC, we assign a team to it, and all of those applications, whether they come in the door at a certain date, one's a little later, one was before, they all operate on their own timetable. Some applications come in and are very thorough, and there's not as much work that's needed up front on our staff standpoint, from our staff standpoint, or in deficiency letters that go back and forth between the developer and FERC staff, and they can move along in a much more expeditious manner. Some have been sitting around for a while, they just aren't as fully developed from a siting standpoint, the application isn't as fully developed, and it takes much longer to do it. Some are more brownfield sites, some are more greenfield sites, but it's a case-by-case situation where they each move forward on their own merit. As you know, DOE had a kind of a chronological order where they were approving export permits, which is their end of things, on a first-in, first-out sort of basis, and you might have projects that were first-in but weren't nearly as far along on the environmental permitting side at the FERC stage, and so you ended up with this mismatch of approvals that were going to projects that maybe were far down the queue, and other projects that were quite high up our queue and are moving along expeditiously were somewhere down the DOE queue. DOE's reformed that and will be not acting on those until they make their way through the FERC process, which I think is a more rational way to handle it, so that the two agencies are, we don't coordinate those things, but from a development standpoint, I think is a net positive.
You know, from the LNG story is why I love being in the energy business, because, you know, exports of LNG 12, 18 months ago was like, oh no, we're not gonna do that. You know, there's two sides to this thing and a big argument. You don't even hear the political discussion anymore. Now we're talking about whether we should export oil, which, you know, was criminal a year ago. So it's kind of incredible to see the changes. And I definitely think that's one of the biggest changes in the last 12 to 18 months. Now it's talking about how much is gonna get exported. Also, in terms of the Canadian projects, we're probably ahead of the Gulf projects a year, 18 months ago. Now it's completely reversed, which is stunning when you think about the size of these projects. When we're talking about the Canadian projects, all probably run $40 or $50 billion from the E&P side of things to the actual export terminals. But I think we also have to be realistic. I mean, you know, history is a good thing for the energy business because, you know, it's 10 years ago when we were seeing things, as somebody said, on the import side. You know, we probably saw 35 or 40 projects there. We built six in North America. Fortunately, Spectra built two of the pipelines to those import facilities with long-term contracts. They may not always be used for import. Some of them will probably be used in the Northeast this year. Surprisingly enough, we're importing gas into the Northeast because of the pipeline infrastructure issues. But you pointed to 35 BCF a project. That's basically on the Gulf Coast. There's another 10 on the East Coast, and there's another 30 in Canada. The uncontracted, I think these numbers are notionally right, the uncontracted demand for LNG globally through 2030 is 18 Bs. So 10 come out of the United States. We're going to get the other 8 too. I mean, there are other people producing gas. And so these projects, we'll probably build half a dozen projects. And FID is only, final investment decision's only been taken on a few. The Gulf projects look very, very good. But it also goes to, you know, this whole issue of leadership. You've seen a fundamental change in the leadership at DOE. You know, bring in Secretary Moniz, who speaks very rationally on issues like fracking, very rationally and economically on issues like export permits, and the next thing you know, they start coming. As opposed to, you know, focus on idealistic problems. Let's solve the problems for the next 40 or 50 years. That's interesting, but not particularly relevant, you know, because it's great. I love all that outlook stuff, but what are we going to do in the next 3-5 years in this country, and particularly in time periods like 2009, 2010, and even now, you know, the economy's not exactly humming. So leadership's been a big aspect of that. I don't think you'll see an overbuild because the economics won't allow that to happen. As I said, you know, the pipeline infrastructure only gets built when contracts are signed. Producers are smart. They're taking on fixed contracts for 15, 20 years unless they're absolutely certain they're going to build. And the odd thing might happen, but it'd be pretty rare to see a pipeline overbuilt in this country because of the nature of contracting.
You know, I think in terms of the numbers, you're basically right on. There's been 30 LNG export projects. About 12 of them have submitted their full paperwork and filings to FERC, and 7 of them have been approved. And that 7 represents 10.5 BCF a day of export capacity. And I'd say, you know, Tony got it exactly right, and I commend the FERC for being very professional in how they do things. And there's a process, there's a timetable. If you do your job in terms of getting all the paperwork in order, having everything wrapped up, you'll move through more efficiently than if you submit, you know, a half complete filing. And I'd also say that the change at the DOE has been very positive. One of the reasons they got overwhelmed with applications was it's cheap to do that. It's only a few $1,000 to go through a full environmental study and get FERC approval, several million. So if you're a developer, you know, and you want to show your investors you did something, you know, you get the DOE permit first. And so that really created a bit of a logjam. And I think them doing the DOE, looking seriously at applications after the FERC's made a lot of progress, makes a lot of sense. And this has been an area where I think the US regulatory frameworks actually function pretty well. There's some kind of growing pains at the start in terms of, you know, in order to permit an LNG export facility, do you need to go back and examine, you know, is fracking bad for the country? Is CO2 bad? And if this enables more gas to be produced, do you have to, you know, it's not a oil or gas well, it's an export facility. So I think the country got around to the right answer there. I do think there's probably room for more liquefaction export capacity to be built in the U.S. I will say being early on counts for a lot. You know, Cheniere will start producing gas towards the end of next year, and had the fortune in part because of, you know, how visionary the company was and seeing the opportunity a bit before other folks and getting in the queue first. They'll be online at least a couple of years before anybody else. And I do think there's to Greg's point, it's not like the rest of the world and the Qataris are sitting back and going to let the U.S. fulfill all the incremental LNG demand. But I do think we're off to a very good start, and having existing regas facilities upon which to build these export facilities is great because it lowers the cost by a lot. It improves the permitting status. Maybe you just need an environmental assessment instead of a full environmental impact study. And U.S. has done pretty well on that, I think. Maybe a little better than Canada, actually, in that between First Nations issues, regional taxation issues, wanting to maintain the peg of instead of pricing natural gas off of a natural gas hub. And there was clearly a lot of interest in that, a lot of demand for that globally, because it gives countries who are buying oil index gas diversity of supply. Most of the Canadian guys have kind of held on to getting oil indexed contracts, and to date it's been a bit tougher for them. So if they keep delaying this, they may miss the boat entirely.
Japanese might like it at today's oil price, though. Right. So.
but one thing I think they know, and they've seen, and we've all seen over the years, those commodities will continue to move. So you don't want to be 100% dependent on just one country for your source of supply, or one source of fuel. And we see it on the power side too. Obviously, having some fuel diversity, whether it's nuclear, coal, natural gas, solar, wind, works a little better than being all one dependent on one fuel source.
Yeah, I think very constructive. I would say that I think the U.S. is a very constructive development environment for LNG, and I think the real governor is going to be, what are the market dynamics? How much, can you actually get the end users to sign up to contracts? Because it's very hard to see. Although these facilities will likely reserve some merchant capacity, you're not going to see a spec LNG facility. So I think that's the real governor, and I think, the numbers that have been discussed suggest that there's potential for some more U.S. export, but doubling in the near term is not in the cards.
Very good. I'd like to switch over to the power side, electricity, for a minute as we sit here in the Northeast. And all the utility folks tell me that we're facing a significantly bad winter again, at least as it pertains to maybe precipitation. Not sure about temperature. We've got in the New England states, we've heard the numbers as much as 50% of the gas-fired power gen on peak day that can't run because there's not enough gas pipeline capacity. Reminds me of the days when I was in-house counsel with pipelines, and we used to have a bumper sticker that said, buy firm or die. How do we get to this point where we've got all this gas-fired power gen that can't run when we need it? Is it really a surrogate for coal-fired retirements? What do we do about that? Do we need power gens to, would the FERC mandate that gas-fired power gens automatically sign up for firm capacity and supply?
Well, we haven't gone that far yet, and I wouldn't anticipate that we'd take quite that tack. I think it's pretty clear that we've had and it's becoming more clear as we've dealt with some of the recent winter issues and some of the filings that we're seeing from the different RTOs and independent system operators, that there's been an undervaluing of generation resources themselves, that they are different from demand response resources and energy efficiency and some of the other things that have developed. There's been a bit of a theory that was in vogue a few years ago, hopefully it's going out of vogue, that there was sort of a magic pixie dust of DR and EE and DG, and it would all come together and it would just obviate the need for any more infrastructure to be built. You wouldn't need generation resources, you wouldn't need transmission lines, you wouldn't need pipelines. I say that not to downplay the importance of some of the newer technologies. I think DG and energy efficiency and demand response are going to play a very important role in future years, but it is to say that we can't undervalue the importance of some of these very basic infrastructure industries that really support the operations of the grid. With regard to this question, which really gets to fuel assurance, it becomes a very regional question in electricity markets. If you're living in a part of the country, which is still the majority of the geography of the country, that is served by monopoly vertically integrated utilities, they're not having as much of this discussion here, because you can build into base rates and through a captive customer rate base the cost of financing a 15-year pipeline contract. You can build into the cost of things like the value of diversity for diversity's sake itself. You can invest in some of these different generation technologies that, if you're in a purely market construct and in a region of the country that's substantially dependent on a merchant generation fleet, the economics today tell you every time, build gas, build gas, build gas. But that electricity market construct that we have is on a one or three-year forward contract basis. merchant fleet, for obvious reasons, isn't particularly interested in signing 20-year gas contracts to firm that up, but it creates a challenge from a FERC standpoint on a couple of fronts. Number one is the issue of infrastructure development on the pipeline side, ensuring that that can happen from a capital formation standpoint. But we're also now seeing that it can have an impact on reliability, as we've seen coming out of the winter operations from last year. If you don't have adequate baseline generation available to come on in the delivery year that it's supposed to be there. FERC has not gone down the path of saying, as a merchant generator, you have to do this specific thing, like have firm contracts for gas. That would appear to be probably too interventionist in the marketplace. We're not going to pick and choose what resources you use to fuel your fleet, but what FERC has been transitioning to, and I think these are the cases to keep a watch out for, has been, we've already approved in ISO New England this particular model. There's a filing that's now before us, so I won't talk a lot about it. It's either just been filed or it will soon, from PJM, which is somewhat similar to what ISO New England has done, which is basically this. It's a capacity performance or pay-for-performance type system in our electricity markets that basically tells electric generators, look, if you get capacity payments, if you enter our capacity markets, you get capacity payments, there comes with that an obligation, and the obligation is that you have to be available in the delivery year that you're supposed to be there. How you make sure that you're available is up to you. Maybe it means more firm contracts. Maybe it means some sort of options contract with LNG. Maybe it means you're building dual fuel units on your generation site. There's lots. Maybe it means you get together with a hydro contract or some sort of wind gas combination contract. There can be all sorts of ways that you as a developer make sure that you have that fuel assurance. But the mechanism that FERC has approved in ISO New England's case and is being proposed in PJM to one degree or another is that if you're a generator that's available and highly reliable and you show up in that delivery year, on the days when you're needed, there's going to be an incentive payment on top of that. The folks who pay that price for that incentive payment are those generators that don't show up that were getting the capacity. So there's a risk and a reward to that. Hopefully that starts to get some of the market signals right so that the generators have the incentive, but also the means to recover the cost of firming up that fuel supply. And FERC will continue. We just issued a notice at our last meeting. We'll continue to focus on this issue of fuel assurance because it's becoming very, very important in an increasingly tight electricity market. When you had 20% operating reserves, you could get by with some slack in the system. And if generators didn't show up, it wasn't as big a deal. When you have very tight reserve margins, which is where we are heading in a lot of the markets for all sorts of reasons, some markets, some environmental regulations, you just can't operate that loose a system.
Yeah, I think, Tony, really importantly that Tony talks about this, the real issue here is New England states. And I think both FERC and state regulators understand their responsibility on many fronts, but number one is ensure reliability of the energy systems in the country. So this is prime number one. You know, last winter, we got really close to having serious problems, brownouts or worse, in New England. Because virtually none of the generation up there, the merchant generation, has any long-term capacity. So people often say, well, we couldn't get the gas, that's why we couldn't run. Well, no, you could get the gas if you had pipelines that you paid for. And the people that have paid for the pipelines are the electric utilities and the gas utilities, largely the gas utilities to date. And, you know, typically the generators had only been needed in the summer, the gas generators. And so we really build our pipelines for peak days, so call it 30, 40 days in the winter, so the generators could come up and pick up the excess capacity in the summer. But now you're relying so much on gas-fired generation at all times in the year, that's not going to hunt. So I don't think it's up to FERC to ask people to hold firm capacity. I guess that's one solution, not particularly a market-driven one. There are several things. Yeah, the spinning, we pay for spinning reserves, the standby capacity payments for generators. You know, maybe as in terms of bidding, maybe you pay a generator, you know, X more per megawatt if they actually do hold certain amounts of pipeline capacity or less. But maybe the best way to do this is actually have the state regulators approve pipeline capacity being held by the local distribution companies, as they do with gas on the electric side. And when that capacity is needed for the generators, then that gets sold at at basically cost or cost plus a bit. And then ultimately all this just gets passed through the consumer anyways, right? So that would reduce volatility, ensure that the pipeline capacity gets built because the utilities will build. You know, we're not particularly keen on building for merchant generators anyways. Very few of them have the credit that you would be able to backstop 20-year type commitments. So there's an opportunity to do that, but I think it's probably done on the state level. The good news is, you know, middle of this year, the New England commission, the New England governors all got together and said, this is a problem. We skated by, no pun intended, last winter and didn't run into a problem, but that might not be the case this winter. So, you know, we are, and the problem's right there right now, and it takes 3 years to build the infrastructure. So we currently have before the FERC a major expansion of our Algonquin pipeline system, $1 billion expansion. That basically will add capacity. Another expansion, and that's for 16. Another expansion that'll provide capacity for 17. And we're currently working with NU, but those are all for gas distribution customers. And the next one is an electric one, but that auction won't come till 18. That's a long ways away before really you're starting to close some of these bottlenecks. And I would say that's probably takes you through inning three of a 9-inning game on what's going to be needed in New England. So there's got to be a economic market solution, and it's probably, you know, put it in the rates of or have the capacity held by the utilities, who can then parcel it out to the generators. Remember, there's a big fact here. Some of the generators, there may be some benefit in not having that capacity, because when capacity is very scarce, what happens to it? Simple supply and demand. It gets very, very expensive to produce power. And, you know, generators don't, the merchant generators don't run that often, so when they do run, they want to sell $1,000 megawatt power. That's not exactly what the regulatory authorities, either federally or statewide, want. So I think you can reduce volatility, get the infrastructure built, it's all good infrastructure, and ensure reliability, but you've got to do it from some type of market mechanism like that, probably at the state level.
I think there's a few key things that are underlying the problem and create the cause of the problem. The first is that unlike oil or natural gas, where you can store it on a reasonably cost-efficient basis, no one's really figured out how to do that with electricity in scale yet. I think the best thing they've come up with is pump storage, which I think they invented 100 years ago. You know, at night, you can pump up water, and during peak, you let it flow down and create electricity. So that's the state of our advanced technology in terms of electricity storage. So absent, and that's why you can't have you know, easy peak shaving. So that's part of the problem. Second part of the problem is you can address that by having excess generation. And I think that's the way the country addressed it in large part for decades, especially while it was all regulated and it's all cost plus and it's one price. You know, it may not be the lowest price you get, but at least it's stable. But then as the country shifted and really not just deregulated, but disaggregated. You know, you had generation being separate from transmission, being separate from the local wires, and there have been a lot of advantages to that. But one of the challenges then is that essentially people don't want to pay to have that redundancy and that excess capacity. One of the reasons they don't want to pay for it is because it's ridiculously expensive. If you're going to invest in a peaking unit in New England, you're not going to run for 350 something days out of the year. So if you don't get $1,000 a megawatt hour for the few hours you run, you'd never do it.
Right.
So I think you have to look, if you can't store the stuff and market's not really willing to pay for it, maybe that's okay to have some periodic power price spikes, because then people do build quick on-off, you know, combustion turbines firing natural gas generation. But I do think where regulators need to step in and think about it is when there's grid reliability issues, or when you could have blackout issues or just major problems. And there you've just got to decide, is it easier to move the electrons or is it easier to move the gas? You could do either one. You know, you can build more transmission lines for power, or you can help Greg out and let him build some more natural gas. I'm hoping that you get some of that gas bill, because we've got a lot in the Marcellus. It'd be great if you could move it up to New York. And there's probably a role for a regulator in facilitating that. And it'll be a combination of, you know, in order to get a capacity payment as a generator in the market, you have to be firm, you have to be able to dispatch, and that means you're going to have to buy firm gas. You know, maybe it's having on the rate on the regulated side more storage, more redundancy that they're not going to get peak prices, but they're not going to deal with trough either. They'll get regulated prices, and the merchant generators can still participate.
Will?
Yeah, so I think, you know, just in terms of the fleet, we see the shift to gas that's been talked about here. I think renewables are obviously on a very strong trajectory, but intermittency issues, and particularly in places like the Northeast, I think, you know, gas is going to be the new generation of choice. And so, you know, I agree there has to be some market support. If you want to reduce volatility, I think that's a key question. If you do, then I think there has to be some market support of the supply in there. So I'm not sure I would put forward a particular solution at the moment. I think, you know, supporting, if you look at a more levelized cost, I think Greg's solution is a reasonable one. I think that some level of support of additional pipeline infrastructure will take that volatility and effectively smooth it out. Ultimately, as has been pointed out, I think this is the cost is going to have to show up in rates. It's just a question of, is it a spike phenomenon, or is it more of a levelized phenomenon?
If I can follow up with David and Will, is if you're investing, if you've got a gas-fired power plant that comes to you in PJM or New England, would you invest in them without them having firm pipeline capacity and supply? Or under what circumstances would you invest without that requirement? Are you comfortable doing that?
Well, I think, you know, we'd have to look at it and just understand the particular dynamics of how the supply would be sourced over time. So we don't have any of those opportunities in front of us immediately, but I think, you know, what we look for is a lot on the offtake side. We look for some pretty good contractual cover. I think we would have to see a very credible source of supply. If it was not a firm, you know, source, we'd have to have a pretty good understanding of why you should be secured supply over time and making such an investment in the current market.
You know, when we invest in energy, especially since we do get into the kind of riskier end of it, we're pretty maniacal about what things we can then mitigate and control, because we're kind of putting ourselves in harm's way. Sometimes we have a little bit of financial leverage, and we really want to focus on, you know, not being right in the long term, but losing the keys in the interim because we had a poor capital structure or we didn't mitigate risk. So in response to the specific question you asked, if we're buying a gas-fired plant in New England, I think, especially if it was a peaker, the whole reason you have that is so that, you know, 8 or 10 days out of the year when power prices are $1,000 a megawatt, you want to be able to hit that and get it. We would definitely want to have firm transmission capacity for gas. I think that makes a lot of sense because there's things that we can kind of, and our management teams can control, mitigate, you know, build an efficient plant, operate it safely. We can't predict the weather. I don't know if gas is going to freeze in at the wellhead or not. If it does, I don't want it to be my problem, especially if I've got a capital structure that has some leverage in it.
Fair enough. Thank you. We've got 10 minutes for questions, but if I can ask one more of the commissioner on this topic. FERC has been very active over the last year, focused on grid reliability infrastructure, and we're now facing down the president's clean power plan and the EPA rules. You all have just announced you're going to have some technical conferences on that topic, and very much making it clear in the notice that you put out that we, FERC, and through NERC, are the ultimate arbiter of reliability. I know that that process is just starting. You're going to have regional conferences. I guess anything's possible, but if you could share with us, what do you see unfolding, and is it possible that it could be that FERC is very active, not to put it in adversarial terms, but somewhat out there in front of the EPA saying, you got to slow down. We can't have these plants retire just yet. Incentives are great, but timing is everything. Any thoughts on that before we close?
Sure. Whenever we come to the clean power plant comes up, we always have to preface it with, should it survive legal challenge? Because that's a very open question. And then you have to also preface it with, should the states themselves decide to implement it? Because, of course, FERC can't, or EPA can't force states to do it. So there's a bit of a timeline here that's going to play out that's probably not quite as rapid as has been envisioned in the initial rounds of the proposed rule itself. Having said that, I do think that FERC has a very unique role, potentially, with regard to the Clean Power Plan, and it's this. If it survives legal challenge, if states start putting together these state implementation plans, there's a number of ways that the implementation plans can roll out. As EPA has said, they've given sort of flexibility to come up with whatever ideas you can come up with to meet the goals. But here's the challenge from a reliability standpoint. You could have individual states coming up with plans. You could have some states get together as regions and submit regional plans. You could have some states say, we're not playing ball at all. EPA, you come up with a federal implementation plan and tell us what it looks like. There has to be some entity that has expertise in grid reliability and the operations of these markets, and these very individualized and sometimes different markets, to look at all of this, these patchwork quilt of plans that form at state and federal and regional levels, and look at them at a 20,000 foot level and say, do these work together? Because it's not hard to construct scenarios in which the requirements that one state implements on its utilities differ from another state's, or what they require for how they want their units to dispatch within different RTOs and ISOs and overlapping utilities with different states and within different RTOs and ISOs could create a real jurisdictional train wreck where you're not operating. At the very least, you could have a lot of price inefficiency in that if it's not done properly, and you could have actual reliability implications if that sort of analysis at the grid-wide level is done. I don't think EPA has that level of expertise in grid reliability. That level of expertise, that engineering expertise, resides at places like FERC and at NERC. And what I've argued for is that Congress can do this, or EPA on its own, I suppose, could build it into its plan. I think that there has to be some sort of reliability backstop where there's some entity with that expertise that looks at the different plans and offers its expert analysis and says, okay, this will work, or just functionally, this isn't going to work.
Very good, thank you. Question?
Yes, I haven't heard any discussion of transactive energy or transactive control. And for those in the room who may not know, you know, in 2015, we have the completion of the first phase of the Pacific Northwest Smart Grid Demonstration Project, which is the largest smart grid demonstration project in the country, really modest $178 million investment over 5 years, which is so pale in comparison to some of the numbers I've heard here in terms of the billions of dollars. So first question, do you track transactive energy or transactive control? And two, even if that is 10 to 15 years out, which we think it might be at Bonneville, why would that not be something at least worth investigating more versus some of the things that I've heard here for, you know, 10x higher than that amount?
Anybody want to take that?
I'll take a crack at it. Investments in the smart grid and what I'll call price-responsive demand-type technologies to me are extraordinarily important, and it solves a conundrum that I think the Commission and markets have gotten themselves into a bit. I'll be very careful in this area because there's some pending dockets that a lot of folks have an eye on with regard to demand response and how they interact in FERC jurisdictional markets. But let me say this. I think the end goal, I would hope, of how the electricity market could play out in a way that's very good for the operations of the system and very good ultimately for consumers is to have more demand response on the demand side of the equation, where you have actual price-responsive demand products that are available in the marketplace so that consumers themselves can react to what's happening in the wholesale markets and can react to that. It's potentially huge savings. We haven't gotten there yet, and even under the current FERC structure, it's not there yet. It's really in recognition of the fact that there is a veil that exists right now between the retail side of our electricity markets and the wholesale side of the electricity markets. That veil is made thick by the fact that we have jurisdictionally a line that's been drawn by Congress, which is that under the Federal Power Act, states have authority over retail rates and how consumers actually see those retail rates on their own bills. Federal government, FERC, has authority over wholesale markets. And so that has made that difficult. I think it's a very worthy endeavor for FERC to continue to work with our state colleagues to see if there are ways that we can begin to break down that veil that exists.
Other questions? Very good. Well, please join me in thanking this distinguished panel.